Sum chinh quỳ. Ông mẹ bác cam bằng to sao bằng nạ ca. Sum chinh lúc mì thư vi ca phía lúc nguồn chía. Bằng to sum nùa. Mình tên rốt bà là cá, tôi chưa riêng trong microphone, hồi cả nhà nè chùm niên phòng.
Good afternoon, Professor Nakagawa, Madam Expert. Can you hear me?
Hello.
My name is Doreen Chen, and I have some follow-up questions for you on behalf of Mr. Nunchia. So first of all, I would like to address a couple of topics that you discussed with my colleague Savannah Liv before the lunch break. And the first one is the chubapsre. You spoke briefly with my colleague about the chubapsre, and I wanted to ask you, to your knowledge, and based on your research, or perhaps your other work, for example, with the Ministry of Women's Affairs, to what extent would you say that the chubapsre is still taught in Cambodia today, whether it be in Cambodian schools or perhaps passed down to Cambodian women by elders?
Thank you very much. Regarding to the
chubapsre,
it was in the official school curriculum to be taught in the primary school, to my knowledge, at least in the primary school.
To
oppress women, to deprive women of freedom, of expression, of freedom, in many issues, still remain.
To be obedient, to submissive, kind, and helping housewife, etc., etc., have been taught.
As a foundation to be a good traditional Cambodian woman.
And as part of those core teachings that you're referring to, are there principles being taught to young Cambodian women, as far as you know today, concerning their traditional role vis-a-vis their husband and vis-a-vis the institution of marriage?
I think it's diverse When we talk about women in Cambodia now, because as I said, Cambodian society is dramatically changing in the last decades. But let's say, for example, if my students in Phnom Penh who are coming to the universities, I can see that they try to express their opinions. They need their freedom. They want their freedom. But in practice, many female students still try to be obedient to their parents. For example, selecting the major to study in your university, or even if they may marry in the future, one of the priorities to find the husband is the agreement of the movement by the parents. So they are still very conservative and traditional. In regard to the young women in the rural areas, or middle-aged women, or elder women in rural areas, I think they are more conservative. They are very much, I would put that they internalize the idea that they have to be obliged to the traditional good Cambodian manifest in
trucks. In your answer, you touched upon the next thing that I wanted to follow up with, you, and that was this concept of there being now a social revolution in Cambodia, especially in the last 10 years. I would like to ask you about that revolution in terms of the concept of consent to marriage. Now, you said, I think, to my colleague, that tradition still remains, but that's changing dramatically. You may not be able to answer this question, but as someone who's studied the institution of marriage in Cambodia and the role of Cambodian women within social fabric here, are you able to estimate the extent to which Cambodian women nowadays are still subject to parental will when it comes to consent to marriage arrangements for their marriage?
Thank you very much. Again, I cannot generalize Cambodian women per se, because there is a huge difference between urban area and rural areas. In urban areas, I would estimate perhaps approximately half of the women are now expressing their opinion to their parents and asserting their opinion with whom they want to marry. Around 50-50, I would say, because I still see my students being forced into unwanted marriage. But in the rural areas, on the contrary, I would say approximately 90% of the young girls, they are waiting for their parents to assign them to marry with somebody, or they dare not to express their opinions, or they even cannot tell their parents that they have boyfriends.
Thank you, Madam Expert. And the last topic I wanted to follow up with you from my colleague's questions was regarding this idea of the role of the local authorities, whether or not they were needing to approve a marriage or just register a marriage. You had some discussion with my colleague this morning about what that role was, registration versus approval. Just to take one anecdotal example, in my own marriage, I was required to seek the approval of the authorities, and that was in that case the French authorities, which I understand to be the administrative tradition inherited in Cambodia. In your research more broadly, did you ever come across research that indicated perhaps how common or how rare it was that authorities that registered a marriage were also required to approve of that marriage?
No, to my knowledge, no, except the DK regime. If I am not wrong, until 2004 or 2005, most of the marriages in Cambodia were not registered.
And I have some follow-up questions for you on behalf of Mr. Nunjin. My apologies, Judge Levan. I was actually referring to my own marriage. So I was married under French law and we had to submit an extensive dossier. I understand that it was slightly different in my case as I was non-French, but I understand that the dossier, the application process by which the mairie reviews the documentation and so on, was normal for the French system. As a foreigner, I had to undergo an additional process of being interviewed. But I'm happy to ask the question in general terms in any case. The point was whether the expert knew as part of her research whether there were, you know, whether local authorities in countries around the world had a role in approving a marriage before it could take place, as opposed to simply registering the marriage after it had taken place. That's the gist of my question. Madam Expert? Did you have any additional comments on that, or have you answered that fully?
Je pense qu'il ne faudrait peut-être pas mélanger trop les règles qui concernent les mariages entre les citoyennes françaises et les gens qui n'ont pas la Autant que je sache, mais peut-être que les lois ont changé. Ça fait très longtemps que je suis au Cambodge. Peut-être que je suis pas venu un petit peu pire avec ce qui se passe en France. Mais il ne me semble pas que les autorités françaises ont pas approuvé le mariage de citoyens français.
Je vous remercie de contribuer très modestement. Pas de mon expérience personnelle, mais de ce que je sais, il y a quand même un dossier à soumettre, il y a des vérifications, ne serait-ce que sur l'âge, ne serait-ce que sur les liens familiaux, etc. Donc il y a quand même une vérification en amont.
Oui, il s'agit de vérifier que le consentement qui est donné par les époux est un consentement qui est éclairé. Il ne s'agit pas d'empêcher des gens qui veulent se marier de se marier.
Hey, I'm not sure if you're going to be able to do this. My guess is the problem, which was probably more extensive, had to do with the fact that you were not a citizen, and most countries actually do this in these cases to avoid citizenship marriages. So that might very well account for it. I'll leave it at that.
That is indeed the case, Judge, and I tried to acknowledge that in my question. The point was, I think, more about the chronology of events. So as I understand it, in many jurisdictions, or perhaps the expert witness can tell us about that, I am aware of jurisdictions where
before a couple can actually get married in a ceremony, they must submit documentation to an authority, and then that authority reviews that documentation and makes a decision that the marriage can go ahead. Maybe that is, as Judge Nguyen says, a rubber stamping exercise, but Madam Expert, perhaps you could tell us about how prevalent this practice might be. Or is it more the case that couples get married in a ceremony and then after the fact they submit documentation to an authority? It's the chronology of the submission of a dossier, as it were.
Thank you very much. I would like to answer in two ways. Number one is I missed out one point that there has been a time when authority actually approved or disapproved the marriage. That is the same-sex marriage in Cambodia. So I have many accounts that the same-sex couples approach the local authority even now, and they were denied the right to marry. So in this sense, that the authority approved marriage and they disapproved the marriage. But for the second point, for chronologically, before the 75, I don't recall any process, as you noted, that dossier was delivered to the local authority. But as I noted, that I remember one woman who appeared in the local authority with her mother and registered the marriage. That's only one case that I recall. But after the Khmer Rouge, when the family law was introduced in Cambodia, I think the lawyers here could reply, which year, maybe 78, that they introduced a new system that there was 1 week prior to the wedding approval, that anybody who wants to make an objection to the local authority. But that was newly introduced system. So I do not have any accounts of such a system before 75.
Thank you very much. Let's move on to a different, less personal topic. You mentioned earlier, yesterday, actually at 9:47 to the President, that your undergraduate degree focused on Pol Pot and how he took power, including from a political science perspective. In this regard, did you study or receive specific training on the structure of the DK regime or the history of the DK? Can you enlighten us a little bit on this?
The answer is no, because when I was in university from 1991 to 1995, there was no scholar in Japan who was studying about Khmer Rouge or modern history of Cambodia or political science in Cambodia. And I was referring and reading those books, historical books, written by many Western
So I didn't have any training. Okay, thank you. I'm going to read you an exchange that you had with the prosecutor yesterday. I'll do this a little bit throughout my questioning just to refresh your memory on where we're at. Yesterday at around 15:03, he was speaking with you about Bridget Toikronen's report, E3/3416. This is what he read to you from the report. The consistency of the description of the ceremonies across geographical areas indicates a top-level policy of forced marriage. There were some variations in how strictly the local administration applied the policy. And then a little later, he read, even in this area, however, it is clear the policy existed. The variation was only in the implementation. Now, the question the prosecutor asked you was, I assume you have read Bridget Toikronen's report. Can you comment on her opinion as to the consistency of the description and the geographical area as indicating a top-level policy and that the variation was only in the implementation? You might recall you said you think that there was a policy from the top level to organize mass weddings, but you didn't have enough evidence, at least now, to say that there was a policy to organize forced marriages. And then he followed up with, the question. Nonetheless, your evidence is that forced marriage occurred in most provinces in Cambodia. Is that correct? And you said yes. So now here comes my question. So you stated that you could not conclude that there was a policy on forced marriage according to your evidence, but that your evidence was that forced marriage occurred in most provinces in Cambodia. On what basis did you conclude that? And in particular, my understanding was that the research on which you based your report, Gender-Based Violence During the Decade, looked at 5 out of Cambodia's 26 or then 24 provinces and was based on in-depth interviews of approximately 100 people. Am I wrong?
Yes, it was correct.
Thank you very much. Now I'm going to read to you a little bit more from a few different documents, and I would then like to get your reaction. And the first document that I wanted to read you is a document that reports something Pol Pot said on the 5th of August 1978 during an interview with foreign visitors. And Mr. President, this is document E3/76, and the ERNs in English are 00170426. And in Khmer, 01327012, and there is no French. Madam Expert, I think this is under tab 4 in your folder if you want to read along. And this is what it says in the document. On building up a family, the young men and young women build up families on a voluntary basis. After marriage, should problems arise within the family, the masses give advice to the partners in order to sort out their problems. Should the parties concerned find it impossible to cohabit any longer, they have the choice of divorce. Neither of the parties concerned needs to go to court. Normally, the question of separation is very rare, as both the husband and wife have a high political consciousness, and each family enjoys a well-guaranteed existence in a national society which is sound and uncorrupt. Therefore, no contradiction is permanent and unable to be settled within the family. That is the first quote. I'm going to read you two others and then ask for your reaction collectively, if that's okay. The second quote I will read to you is from a witness that my colleague, Liv Savannah, has already spoken with you about. And this is a commune chief in Cheng Tong Commune, which was in District 105, which is Trong Kok District in Takao. And, Mr. President, I am reading from the transcript E1/297.1, and that is the transcript from the 5th of May 2005, and I'm reading from around about 1348. And this is the quotation. So the question put to the witness was as follows. Was the marriage and family policy of the CPK based on two principles? First, that both parties agree to the marriage, and second, that the collective agrees. And if that is the case, then two people could get married. The answer from this commune chief was, yes, that is true. And then finally, the third quotation I wanted to read to you is from somebody who was on the district committee in Bare District in Kampong Thom. And Mr. President, this is document E3/5293. And the ERNs in English are 00351705. In Khmer, 00348844-45, and in French, 00367751-52. Madam Expert, here is the quotation. This is the witness speaking. When there was a joint meeting among the district committee and the sub-district committee, then the decision on the marriage would be made. The marriage criteria were, firstly, the issue of age. The girls would have to be at least 18 years old. Secondly, both persons loved each other dearly. And thirdly, the parents approved the marriage. Madam Expert, these excerpts, we would say, suggest that at the higher level, the policy on marriage, according to the CPK, fundamentally required consent of both spouses as a precondition. Could you give us your views on this?
I am also keen to know the answer, but I cannot conclude only from the statement that there was a uniform policy from the top level. And we need more volume of evidences to show that there was a centralized policy on how the marriage would be arranged. So my answer is no.
Thank you. Is it correct to say that according to the evidence that you obtained in your research, it was, as far as you knew, commune and village chiefs who were in charge of marriages?
Yes, that's correct. Mostly it was village chief. And because those single people were belonging to the group, the group leader was also in the, I'm not pretty sure, in the selection process, but they were often the one who informed the person that they are going to marry.
Thank you. Now I would like to read you a quote from your own report, Gender-Based Violence During the DK. Mr. President, this is E3/2959, and the ERN in English is 00421892. In French, it is 00701496. And in Khmer, it is 00 73 83 46. Madam Expert, what you said, as we've recorded, is as follows. An objection to an order to marriage given by the uncle might have resulted in torture or death. Thus, most of respondents agreed to get married. My question in this regard is, could you please explain to us how you reached this conclusion, and particularly on which basis, which individual or document you used as a source, if you can remember?
With more evidence, confirm this as of now. But at the time when I wrote the book, I was based on the evidences that I gathered from the fieldwork.
Can you give any impressions as to how prevalent that was, how many people said this, or any impressions in that regard as to the data set that was being used?
I'm very sorry, but it's 10 years ago and I don't have any records, so I cannot give you the accurate number.
Very understandable. That's fine. We looked at the different quotations that you used in your report, and there were two that interested us. It's the same document number, Mr. President, and I'll be referring to the ERN 00421892-4 in English, 00701496297 in French, and 00 73834648 in Khmer. Madam expert, the two examples that you gave were as follows. The first one, you were citing to an example of a man who was taken to prison because he did not agree with Angkar's choice of a wife. That's the first one. The second one, a few pages later, you cited to two examples. One was of a woman who was threatened with rape if she did not agree to get married. And the other was someone whose niece was raped after she refused to marry. From our understanding, that's three people in total who were punished for this refusal. What we're wondering is, how are you able to tell that these were not, for example, the actions of rogue Khmer Rouge soldiers, but instead something that occurred throughout the DK? Would you agree that at least it was a possibility that this was a rogue action?
The I do not have an actual number of how many men or women were tortured or attacked as a result of refusal, but from my interviews with the people, they knew that the refusal to the Khmer Rouge instruction to marry would result in the torture or to the death. So there was a terror among the people. Despite the fact it might be a very small number of people who actually suffered, I want to point out that people knew.
Thank you. I'm again going to read to you some excerpts. One of them is of the commune chief from Cheng Tong, who we've discussed before, and this is still Mr. President E1/2971. From the 5th of May 2015, a transcript, and the time point is 10:03. Madam expert, this is the exchange happening at this point. The witness answers, "In my opinion, there were no forced marriages, but if the couple agreed to get married, we forced them to get married." Then the question comes, "Is it fair to conclude that in your commune there were no examples of people forcibly married to each other?" Her answer is yes. Follow-up question, to be clear, if anybody, any man or any woman, did not want to marry another woman or man, then this person could tell so. Is that correct? And that person wouldn't have to marry. The answer is yes. And now, another excerpt. This is of a party member, a member of the district committee of the same district, Trang Kok, in the southwest of Dakar. And Mr. President, this is a document. E1/291.1, and the time point is at the 23rd of April 2015. And Madam Witness, Madam Expert, my apologies, this is the quotation. In fact, on the practice or on the regulations of the marriage, we discussed amongst ourselves at the districts under the guidelines from the zone. And from my observation, there were some gaps in the practice because not everyone consented to the marriage. And as I knew, we were so busy at the district level, and sometimes we gave such authority to the unit chiefs. And as a result, for those couples who consented to the marriage, they were happy living together. But for the others, they did not. Now, that's quite a lot of information, I appreciate. I've discussed with you documents which showed the official policy regarding marriages during the DK, which was based on the consent of two individuals and that of the parents. Now, these two individuals, who were respectively working at district and commune level, said that the rule was that consent was sought, but that there could be discrepancies in the implementation or practice. This is similar also to what you said yesterday. So, for example, asked if a man or woman was able to refuse in order to get married, at 1408 you said it is very diverse. At 14:10, you were asked whether the possibility to refuse to marry existed in all parts of the country or could be limited to a region, and you said you heard about this possibility everywhere that you visited. And then later you said that it might depend on the location, the governance system for the location, and the year, in your opinion. Now, a lot of information, I know. If I understand your evidence properly, your position based on your research, is it that there was a possibility of refusals to marry someone, even in cases where UNCA, quote-unquote, ordered it, but that it depended very much on the local authorities? Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. And that's why I said that I cannot find any evidence of centralized policy to force the people into the marriage.
Thank you.
You also spoke to the prosecution earlier about the impact that it might make to have a sympathetic or strict village chief on the one hand or the other. Would you agree that the existence of a climate of fear in the daily lives of men and women depended in large part on the approach of the local authority like the village chief?
Yes, I agree. But unfortunately, I have never, before any interview, that people told me that Khmer Rouge was kind.
Thank you. Regarding your interviews for a moment, out of perhaps, I don't know if you can answer this, but out of the 1,500 survey respondents in your baseline study, or perhaps the number that you spoke to then more in depth, can you say how many reported that they were married without consent or that of their parents being provided in a non-coerced way?
Just for clarity, the expert has undertaken a number of studies in relation to forced marriage, the 1-2008, the 1-2014, or 2-2014, which was the Khmer that you were researching in child soldiers. Just wondering if the question is referring to the first report or the
Thank you for the question. Indeed, I wasn't very clear. I was referring to the first report on which the baseline survey of 1,500 people was undertaken. But I'm happy to discuss it more broadly as well to see if your opinion has changed over time.
Thank you very much. For the first research conducted in 2006, I do not recall many cases. It was not very many, but it's not small numbers. When I started this research, my purpose was to document the stories of sexual violence, and in the course of interviews, both men and women started to talk about forced marriages. So I failed to document the numbers and percentage of forced marriages in my first study. And in my one of the latest studies on the mother of war that interviewed more than 200 people who became the mother or father in the Khmer Rouge time, my impression is that those who marriage was not many.
តាមចម្លើយរបស់ខ្ញុំការរៀបការដោយបង្ខំមិនច្រើនទេ
instructed to marry by their parents
but thank you very much.
I'm going to move on to a slightly different issue here. This morning I heard you say that Cambodian parents, as far as you know, would never discuss the issue of sex with their children. Would it be correct to state that Cambodian society, both before and after the DK, is conservative regarding sexual interaction?
Yes, that's correct.
The younger generation nowadays have the freedom to access information through the Facebook and the internet, but those who have no access to the information in ICT, they were mostly not accessing to the information, and the discussion in the family about sexuality is very rare.
And now shifting the question towards the DK itself, equally, do you believe that the DK was conservative when it came to sexual interactions as a society?
I would say yes to that question, and when I inquired people about the moral offense, the people all knew about moral offense, but they would refer it in a very soft way, that it's a relationship between men and women. And if I try to investigate more about the meaning of relationship between men and women, it could lead to casual conversation to the sexual relationship. So I would assume that discussing about sexuality is before the Khmer Rouge and the Khmer Rouge, it is a social interaction.
Thank you. I'll come back to the concept of moral offences very shortly. But first, there was something we're hoping you can help us with. Do you think that it makes sense in a society that's as sexually conservative as the DK to have had these chlop, the village militia, listening at the door of newlyweds to hear whether they were consummating the marriage, particularly when, as you mentioned, these chlop were often young children or teenagers?
Yes,
I think it's possible, because Khmer Rouge wanted to show that they are in control, that people have no freedom. So it's a symbol.
And my last question on this point, do you think that it would be possible that to the extent that a couple's sex life would have been monitored during the DK, that this was something that was decided at the local level with no involvement of the higher authorities of the center?
I have to apologize. I have no evidence to answer to your question, but my impression is that not all forced marriages couple are monitored. So the assumption is that it depends on the local authority to decide it in order to create more terror among the population.
Thank you. Now moving to a brief discussion of moral offences. Would it be fair to say that it's your position that there was a strict policy against rape during the DK, but that perpetrators were not necessarily punished because higher authorities didn't always know about the crime being committed?
Yes, that's correct. Yes, that's correct. That there was a very strict policy.
And everybody knew about it. And I think that
the higher authority failed to implement that policy.
So the policy to protect women were used to attack women.
Thank you. Now I'm going to go back again to your first book, Gender-Based Violence during the DK, E3/2959. And I want to talk about another example that you give. And the ERN in English is 0042-18938-4. In French, 0073-1495. And in Khmer, it is 0073-834-6647.
My apologies, Mr. President. The English ERNs are 0042-18938-94. In French, 0073-1495. And in Khmer, 0073-834-6647. And I'm sorry, I don't have the page number for you, Madam Expert. But in this example, you refer to two examples of women who were raped because they refused to marry. My question, my follow-up question is, would it be possible that the rape of the two women that you spoke to for refusing to marry was something which was done through the abuse of power by local cadres in violation of the official policy and the sixth principle that we've discussed concerning rape?
Yes, that's correct. Any sexual violence is an abuse of power.
Thank you. And now I would like to refer to some answers that you gave to the civil party lawyers yesterday afternoon and to the judges this morning with regard to this prohibition on rape. Now, in light of the strict prohibition on rape in DK official policy, and then the fact that, as you've already discussed, in at least certain locations, and as we've discussed, in certain official documents, marriage was based on consent. Why do you conclude, as you testify in these two places, that it was legalized rape and not recognized as a crime? Can you give us a little bit more information about this? To be a little clearer, we're discussing those were responses that you were giving with respect to consummation of a marriage in the context of a forced marriage. You concluded that it would be considered legalized rape and would not be considered a crime. Can you enlighten us a little bit on this in light of the context of DK policy?
I try to answer, but I may be wrong the way the police guided me up to my answer. But what I meant was, in the ordinary circumstances, if a man or woman raped the other woman or man, that's a crime. And we understood it as a crime. But during the Khmerish time, the newly married couple should have had sex. By failing to do so, was a crime.
ហើយបើការបានមិនធ្វើអញ្ចឹងទេវាជាគ្រោះកម្មទៅវិញបើពួកគេមិនព្រមរួមដំណេកគឺវាជាគ្រោះកម្មដូច្នេះដើម្បីជៀសវាងកុំឲ្យមានការដាក់ទណ្ឌកម្មឬក៏ការដាក់ទោសបុរសឬក៏ស្ត្រីទៅនោះត្រូវតែរួមដំណេកជាមួយគ្នាហើយយើងយល់ថាការរួមដំណេកហ្នឹងជាការរំលោភសិទ្ធិសន្តិវៈក៏ប៉ុន្តែខ្មែរក្រហមគេអនុញ្ញាតអាផាធីឬក៏បង្ខំឲ្យភាគីរួមដំណេកគ្នា It was legal that the husband raped a wife,
Yes, that's perfectly clear, actually. You understood the gist of my question, even though my question was a little garbled. Now, just a follow-up question in this regard, and again, I'm not sure if you'll be able to answer this, but in the course of your research on this particular subject, so we're talking about marital rape, did you come across any information on how common it was around the world or how rare, at the time of the decade, so 1975 to 1979, that countries criminalized marital rape?
I do not think so that it was common internationally.
Thank you. Now, a few quick follow-up questions on another topic. Now we are talking about marriages to handicapped soldiers. In your book, you refer to two persons who were married with disabled soldiers, and perhaps this is something that you then came across a little more in your research. But amongst the 1,500 individuals that you surveyed in your initial baseline survey for your book, or in your future research, can you tell me approximately how many people were arranged to marry a disabled soldier?
I'm very sorry, I have no answer. Second question on this point.
Yesterday you testified that you heard many accounts that young women would be very scared to get married with disabled soldiers. Can you enlighten us a little more on why this would be so? Why would they be scared of disabled men in particular or disabled soldiers in particular?
I would try to avoid any discriminatory comments, but at that time, both men and women were living under extraordinary hardship, and I didn't believe that they should have avoided it.
By any means, unfortunately, even with the ordinary will, for survival, marriage is acceptable.
And this is something that was relayed to you in the in-depth interviews that you undertook?
Yes, it accounts from both mothers and fathers and the young women.
Thank you very much. I'm now moving to my last area of focus. We'll spend quite some time here. And my interest here is in understanding more about your research and the methodology that you used. So there'll be quite a lot of questions on this subject. My first question is about your first report. According to your CV, you undertook research on sexual violence during the decade for 10 months between April 2006 and January 2007, if I'm not wrong. Is this correct? And was this the field research that was done in the context of your work with the CDP and for your first report, April 2006 to January 2007?
The period that has been noted is starting from the month or date when I was granted
the farm from KJJ. So in April after the new year,
I started the preparation.
Yes, that's correct. I was looking for somebody to sponsor my study for about 1 year. And they are the only one who kindly helped my research.
And did they, or did CDP or any other entity, give you any guidelines or instructions regarding the scope or goal of your research?
Goal of research.
I do not think so because I had a great passion to do this research and I knew what I wanted to do. So I don't have any guidance from OSJJ. They just let me do the research and I was very lucky to have an excellent intern in my office who could help to also form the research review.
Now I'm going to dig a little more deeply into the methodology that you used for your report, and we'll also talk a little bit about Bridget Toikronen's report, just because the two appear to be interrelated as far as the data set is concerned. Now, the report written by Bridget Toikronen, for which you acted as a research manager, as I understand, it describes itself as discussing, in part, redress for the victims, including the chances for prosecution in the ECCC. And we do know that many of the civil parties here at the tribunal are represented by CDP, which was the institutional partner for the report. To the extent that you can answer this, was one of the goals of Bridget Toikronen's research, and perhaps your research, to find victims of gender-based violence during the DK with a long-range view to supporting these victims to pursue cases at this tribunal?
My memory might be lost, but I was starting to formulate how the research should be done. And the approach to me to give them the information about the information that I spoke and documented in the report.
nâu chư mùi ông ca CDP khi nhóm chìa bật thiên thân này cả bọc phùm sai phòng đại hơi CDP miền phân này mùi thiết này dây tạm bì bư hăng xa không khu xa tì hỏi miền nẹ mạng chật chẳng hơi đâm bấy chui đò spray đèl chỉ chôn rung cửa nền bờ hàng sạc nông cửa xa hai dương bàn xâm rải thạc thật thà. Bên nốt đại cụ khiếm có bàn mật vực cả hỏi khi dương trâu pra thuân thiên đè miền xa rạp. Nơi khả nông phân này bờ hàng sạc nông cửa xa hai dương ôi nẹ tăng nốt chôn rung khả nông ca sắc xa xa rạng chi riêu. Hỏi phụ khót vực cả nơi khả nông khai pram đại dương chi rửa rửa. Chẳng phụ tệ tôn nâng ca riêng chom tà ràng xung nua vĩnh hay Bridget nâng khiếm chê nẹ thư ca ruông khả nì hay dương phư tệ môn nâng dọc từ bà
A couple of follow-ups in that regard. The first one, actually, about Bridget Tokunen. I think you mentioned this yesterday, but I'm not sure if I heard correctly. Did I understand that she was an intern at CDP at that time?
Yes, she came. We had a lot of
dance summers at the CDP Cambodian Defense Project. I also had some, but she came from Harvard University to work in the Department of Domestic Violence. And she was looking for something interesting. And she talked with me that she wanted to do research on witchcraft or something. And I just took the opportunity to also utilize high expertise because she's a super excellent student.
I know you've mentioned that they received an intensive training and they in turn trained other sentinels. Did they follow a research protocol in interviewing the survey respondents?
Yes, and they were
very
I would say they are already experts because they have been supporting women who have been supporting women. Quote, some provinces yielded more informants than others, perhaps because of higher rates of sexualized violence and forced marriage in the area or due to the greater commitment of the sentinels to the project in that province. Unquote. I would just like your comment on what this greater or lesser commitment of the sentinels meant and how, as far as you saw, it impacted on the survey results.
Let me try to we had 50 sentinels, and everybody also had different commitments. Everybody had a family. So the degree of the commitment to the research was diverse. And let me try to think where I went. Are there any differences? I think that for me, it was not a very big deal because the sentinel who guided me in each place, because they always came to see me or I went to see them first, and then we visited together to the house of the interviewee, and then I was doing interview alone. And they were all very well known to me, and they were very kind to me, and even didn't see them, I saw only those who were very good, who managed to
to arrange the field work for me through other
students.ការងារមូលដ្ឋានត្រូវជួបអ្នកណាណាជាដើមនឹងមេធាវីសមអរគុណ
សូមជឿលោកចក្រមសូមមក
Oui, c'est une observation générale.
បាក់យមិនការកត់សម្គាល់ជាលក្ខណៈទូទៅមួយ
តាមរយៈ les interprètes se plaignent de la vitesse à laquelle ការបកស្ដាប់បច្ចៈខ្ញុំនោះខ្ញុំ
ឮអ្នកបកប្រែគាត់លោកលោកតំថាអ្នកសួរនឹងមេធាវីនឹងសួរលឿនពេកអញ្ចឹងគាត់មិនអាចបកប្រែតន់ទេអញ្ចឹងសូមលោកស្រីមេធាវីបន្ថយល្បឿនបន្តិចសូមដើម្បីឲ្យភាគីនឹងក៏យល់ច្បាស់នៅសំណួររបស់លោកស្រីផង
My apologies, Judge. I'm just very conscious that I'm running out of time, but I will speak slower. Madam Expert, I want to go very briefly from what was talked now about the 1,500 survey respondents that you interviewed, the Sentinels interviewed. And then, as part of your research, the data set reduced to approximately 100 individuals. Now, in Bridget Tokronin's report, E3341, and the ERN 004495-02 in English. I don't have the others at the moment. My apologies. She talked about how the 100 interviewees were focused on victims or eyewitnesses. I just want to understand.